I was working in Kansas City as a file clerk for Internal Revenue, and I learned that there was a chance to go to night school on a 3-night-a-week basis, and there was on the GI Bill where you could go to school and get paid to go. This was in 1948. I remember the guy that ran it, Waldo Hazelburg Brazil, and he looked exactly like Xavier Cougat. He really did. And the name of the school was the Pathfinder School of Radio. Another former KBOA employee went to that same school, Charlie Watson. Charlie and I got acquainted. One of the first people I got to know, he lived in Hornersville, and his dad ran a service station there. And he and I got acquainted, and he came around the station. I was working as a DJ at night. Charlie came out and sat in and watched me, and he got interested, and then we stayed in. We used to sign off at 10:15. And so Charlie, we'd turn off the transmitter and then keep everything else on, and Charlie learned to operate the turntables and read the news and practice, and he was real good in several months' time. And then I recommended to him that he'd go ahead and go to school, and then maybe we could get him back at KBOA with that, and he did, and we did. And, you know, Charlie turned out to be one of our top people. Going ahead about the school, I got paid, I think, like $90 a month to go to school. And I just did that. I was working as Internal Revenue file clerk, and it wasn't very interesting, but it was a living in Kansas City. And I decided I need to pick up a few extra bucks, and I read this ad about, you know, you could do this. So I went just to pick up the dollars. I got to liking it, and it just kind of, you know, fitted into something different for me, and I really liked it. What I was doing, so I quit my job and went to day school full time. Got a little more money, $120 a month. The school was a 6-month school, and in about 5 months, Mr. Brazil said, "Hey, you know, anytime you're ready to go, I think you're ready. She'd like to get you a job." My first time on the air, we had a thing through the school where KCKN, Kansas City, Kansas, worked with us, and I don't remember any names, but I got to do a 5-minute newscast over KCKN, Kansas City, Missouri, through the school. We had a studio in the school. And I remember how nervous I was. That was the longest 5 minutes I ever experienced in my life. But, you know, that was my first time. And then what I did, I had written, after he told me, go ahead, I had written every radio station in the state of Missouri. Don't think there was even 100 stations. I don't recall. I remember I wrote quite a few letters, and I mailed them to every station in the state of Missouri. And I heard from one by phone within a week. And it was KBOA, and they had a guy had just quit. His name was Lucky Watkins. He was the nighttime announcer, and he was working with the late Charlie Harrison, who used to be station manager and sportsman at KBOA FM in those days. And he was the chief announcer, Charlie Harrison, and Lucky was working with him, and Lucky just quit all of a sudden without any notice, take another job. And so Ray Van Hooser, most people knew him as Ray Van. He was the station manager, and he ran the old camp meeting. He was the originator of it on KBOA. And he called me, and he hired me over the phone. I took a train to Poplar Bluff, and he picked me up, and I talked his leg off. I was using all the vowels properly in those days. I was really keyed up, you know, and wanted to make a good impression. And I was in for a big letdown because I was taught in school like they do it in the big city. You didn't have to run the board in school. They had an engineer, and you didn't have to play the records. You had a script you went by. And that's how I was taught to be a radio announcer, like I was going to go to Chicago or somewhere. And the first few weeks of that night shift, well, I was ready to go back to Kansas City. But I made it. Well, I got here on a Friday afternoon late and went to work Saturday night. And, you know, Charlie Harrison was a big help, though. Charlie, in fact, he's the one that made me make it. He said, "You can do it." And so it was on May 12th. The station was, went on the air in July of 47, and I came in May of 49. So the station was a year and 10 months old, the AM. And the FM went on in 48 and was approximately a year old. The chief engineer, the gentleman that built the station from the ground up, was the late Bob Connor. Rudy Pilot was here. Ray Van was the station manager who ran the old camp meeting. Joe Bankhead was the sales manager. He started with the station on the first day. Johnny Mack, who was you know, put the station on the air on the first day. He was just an AM announcer and the newsman. They had moved out of a Quonset hut before I got here. The building was about half the size it is now. That was it. And we were sitting on top of each other in those days. We were on AM and FM at the same time. And it was the same programming, and then at night we stayed on till 10:15. But we had a lot more country music. We had a lot of live entertainment, usually 15-minute programs, occasionally a 30-minute one. We'd have two or three, maybe even four quartets on in a day's time. We did it every day. And in those days, we had sponsors like, I remember, Pure Snowflower, and some of your national accounts would sponsor these local country bands because they were big things. And they made a living. They'd play, and then they'd go out at night and have their show dates all over this part of the country, and they were paid good. One of the real good bands was Curly Hickson and his Rhythm Busters, and some of those guys are still around. Billy Springer played a fine steel guitar, and Curly is up at Camel still, best I know. Gabby McCune, he was slapping the bass. Then we had, you can't mention country music around this part of the country without Chuck Harding and the Colorado Cowhands. And Cousin Chuck wrote some of his own songs. He's still in the business. He does gospel work out in Texas now. And then getting to the quartets, we had some top-notch quartets. We had one of the good quartets was the All-American Quartet with Manuel Battles, the McDonald Brothers, and the Melody Men, and we had those three good quartets that I can recall. Then we had a lot of church programming during the day. We had, I'll never forget one guy. His name was Jack Henderson, and he just kind of sauntered in off the streets, and he had a guitar, and we put him on the air, and he sold songbooks. And I remember his theme song very well. "'Tis sweet to be remembered." That was his theme song. He opened every show, and he talked real smooth. And he sang gospel songs by himself, and he did a good job, had a good voice, and he sold songbooks for a dollar. Apparently, he made enough money that he left here, and he went down south and bought himself a radio station. On Sundays, when we had the big crowds, we had a lot of live church programs. We'd have them in the morning and in the afternoon, all day on Sunday. And many of the people from the church came out. I've seen as high as 100 people crowded in that big studio. I can remember we had Reverend C.R. Young, a little brick church of Zenith. People came and they listened and they supported their preacher. And we had some other gospel singers. I remember Little Troy Lumpkin. He was a good singer, and his wife, they sang together. They sold a lot of songbooks. There were a lot of good shows, and some of them I took over from somebody who moved on up the ladder. I ran Old Camp Meeting for over a year. You know, I strictly played records. I was not a personality disc jockey, never was. I was a straight announcer, as we call it. Johnny Mack had a show that was very popular called the All Request Jamboree. And I remember that the opening theme song was Cherokee by Charlie Barnett. In those days, you could mail in a penny postcard or a letter with a 3-cent stamp, and that's how you got your songs on the air. You wrote in, and we read every letter. And we got hundreds and hundreds of cards and letters, most always pop. We had country music, but we didn't have a country show for a long time where you could request. And then we hired a disc jockey that a lot of people will know, Jimmy Haggett. When Jim came to work, he started getting requests. We ended up with a big contest one time. Pop music against country music. And you voted with a penny postcard whether you like pop music or country music the best. And the way it turned out, the guy that got the least number of cards had to push the other guy in a wheelbarrow wearing a pair of long underwear. Long underwear that had been dyed and a white stripe sewed up the back. And it was hot. He had to push me all the way from Price's West Y service station out to the Chevrolet place where the parade ended, and Jim had to push me. I won by a little bit. We pulled, if I recall, we pulled well over 13,000 pieces of mail, either cards or letters, in 1 month's time, and that was a lot of mail. It was in the middle 50s, if I remember. I remember one that I did. It was really tough to do till you got used to it, and that was on the nighttime shift. We had a show called the Mythical Starlight Ballroom. We only had two turntables in those days, and what we did, we tried to simulate doing a live band from a nightclub. And we had on one of these big 16-inch discs, we had one long cut that would go for 5 or 10 minutes of crowd, just crowd hubbub, and then we had another one with applause and, you know, hollering and everything. So we'd have on one of our turntables the theme song, we'll say it was Benny Goodman and Let's Dance, and we'd start off. You know, ladies and gentlemen, we now take you to the mythical Starlight Ballroom located on the beautiful shores of Lake Missouri. Tonight, it's the music of Benny Goodman and his orchestra. And here come the theme song, and then I'd reach over and turn up the other turntable while the music was playing, and here would come the yell and the applause. And you'd simulated that you was actually doing a remote from a nightclub with this top band. And this actually happened. I had salesmen who were staying somewhere in one of the local hotels or motels would call up and say, how do you get to that place? Well, I'd have to explain to them while the record was playing that this was, you know, mythical. And, of course, they were slightly disappointed. But, you know, it wasn't good like that at first. It took me about 3 months to get that thing down smooth. And, you know, a lot of people weren't fooled until you got it down smooth. And that was a toughie. Of course, baseball was a big thing, and we carried Cardinal baseball in those days, and we were the only thing going around here. We had Smiley Burnett, you remember him, that was Gene Autry's sidekick. He was here, and we got to interview him and played some of his records. Sonny James, he was from the Rector area. But one of the big ones, and I got to tell something on myself on this, was Elvis Presley. Jimmy Haggett was our country DJ. And he brought Elvis Presley to appear on a Saturday night at the B&B Club. It's no longer there, but it was a beer tavern. Jimmy was good at booking. He had a lot of contacts down in Memphis area. But Elvis was not the headliner. String Bean was a headliner that night, and I went out to see him, not Elvis. But Elvis hung around the studio, and I've told this story before, and a lot of people have heard it. And I remember hearing Elvis on Sun Records, and Elvis kind of, he didn't impress me, and I'm the guy who said, this guy got nothing. You know, he'll never make it. He started doing great when the Jordanaires started backing him vocally, and it dressed up his records. He was doing pretty good even before that, but he just kept sounding better and better. And I remember Jimmy telling me that he had Elvis booked into the B&B Club for $100. You know, that was pretty big money for Elvis in those days, $100. I think String Bean may have got a little more than that. But no, that was the only time that Elvis, I think, was ever in our studios, was the time that Jimmy had him up here for that appearance that night. And he talked to him, but nobody was real excited about it in those days. When John Reeder, or we called him, and the folks know him as Johnny Mack, was promoted to station manager, I was promoted from daytime announcer, and I'd helped John a little bit in news to the job as news director, and I spent 8 years in that capacity. I got to say this about that job. It's the most fascinating job of a radio station, but it was the hardest job. You're on call all times, and invariably the 4th of July, you could plan on spending out on some ditch bank or riverbank while they dragged for somebody who'd come down visiting and drowned. 57, bunch of people east of Kennett were evacuated, nearly 100 people, and they were taken down to the Kennett Armory, they called it, and were housed there for a night or two. And I remember putting some radio equipment, very heavy radio equipment, on my back out at the floodway ditches, and there was some talk of some people dynamiting a levee to relieve the situation in their particular area to get, you know, so they wouldn't get as much water. And I remember getting in a boat with Herdy Boyd and this heavy equipment on my back, and we went downstream. We got down, we discovered the break and did some tape. You know, we weren't doing live reports in those days like you can do now. It was fine going down, but coming back, we was bucking that up that current, and man, I didn't think we was going to make it. I got out of that equipment. But I remember going down to the armory after that and interviewing a lot of those people who had been displaced because of the floodwaters. Congressman Jones owned the Daily Duncan Democrat in those days, and we had the hometown newspaper of the air. The announcer, and I think it was Johnny Mack, he didn't write the news. The paper sent somebody out with the stories. And we read it, and it was written for newsprint, so it was a little bit different. And we read the news for several years, written for newspaper. But finally, the congressman sold the paper, and then we started doing it on our own. One other show I wanted to mention that I had a lot of fun with was called Coffee Time. This was a show I think our hometown news was only 15 minutes. And we had a show that came on immediately after that called Coffee Time, and we had a theme song, It's Coffee Time, My Dreamy Little Friend, It's Coffee Time, and we played middle-of-the-road music, and then we read stuff for the house. It was a housewife-type audience, and we had a girl named Suetta Ray, who was the record librarian. We used to have record librarians in those days where somebody, a girl, hired specifically to file all of the records that came in. We used to get a lot of free records, you know, from all of the major companies, Capitol, Mercury, RCA, you name them. We got them all, and they sent them out because they wanted them played. And we didn't have to buy them in those days. And so we had a record librarian. So we had a 15-minute show where we read news tips, household tips, recipes. It was a lot of fun, and we played some soft music. Some of the other shows I remember, it was an evening show. This was when I first came down, called Eventide Echoes. Eventide Echoes was a program where you read prose, and you had this real soft music in the background. And a lot of times it was organ music. You know, that was pretty fancy for this part of the country, but it got pretty sentimental. It was kind of mushy that we did in the evening just as the sun was going down. We used to get script shows. You know, they'd have an introduction written out. I remember there was a big library called Standard on the big 16-inch, and we had a lot of shows like that. We had some even classical shows that none of us really did very well with. We tried to pronounce the Italian opera star names and so forth. It's still an honorable, good profession, one that I recommend to anybody. You got to like it to be in it 30 years, you know that. And, you know, it's something that not everybody's cut out to do. And I think that any young man or woman that would like a career that's rewarding, maybe not always monetarily necessarily, but something you enjoy doing, you won't stay long if you don't like it. I've seen them come and get in radio, and it just wasn't their cup of tea. It takes somebody that kind of likes it. I guess you got to be a little bit of a ham.